Hi, Leute. a good example of the insidious nature of some of that intrusion, I would point to the May 2018 VPN filter, right, where Russia actors were targeting SOHO routers. We saw APT28 Fancy Bear hauled out in the Cisco Talos reports, estimated hundreds of thousands of devices were affected worldwide. So that malware had really creative ways of interacting. It went out and it was trying to get Instagram pictures to decode out of the metadata the IP address that it should use.
What?
Command and control.
Weißt du, in den Instagram-Bildern sind es Metadaten drin, als auch, die sind doch, hä, ich dachte, die filtern sowas. What the fuck? Das habe ich auch nicht mitbekommen. Quantity first, quality second, China. By the way, der Server ist jetzt auf 1.15, die jetzt kürzlich rausgekommen ist. Also immer up to date hier.
Show that they're trying to stay ahead and use that tactical advantage. And then even perpetuating a domestic legal regime where they have to have intellectual property transfer from companies who want to do business with or in China. So participating in the Chinese markets using their national laws to kind of edge people in ways that are not exactly cyber, but aimed at some of the same outcomes. Again, theme here, a lot of countries are looking at more than just cyber operations, but cyber in part of a bigger, larger activity. So Iran, as U.S. and Iran entered into the nuclear agreement framework talks 2015, Iran really seemed to curtail a lot of the destructive cyber activity against Western interests. They still went against Saudi Aramco and other big issues there. But what we saw was denial of service campaigns that had been disrupting the banks and targeting the banking industry dropped off a lot. They even came after, at one point, a Las Vegas casino, right, where the CEO had made some public statements about wanting to attack Iran, and so they came back and defaced the casino's websites. So what we see is Iran willing to use their cyber influence in real-world operations, at a level that is targeted and malicious, that we don't see other states behaving in similar ways. So I think of note, you know, when bilateral relations between Iran and Saudi Arabia decreased.
Oh my God, these are FK.
That was a major factor in the January 2017 data deletion attacks in Saudi. And so, you know, as we move to a point where the U.S. has just reimposed sanctions on Iran, there's a lot of focus on how are they going to respond. And one opportunity they have is certainly in the cyber realm. So I know as NSA, we're going to be very vigilant and watching closely in that space. The world needs to join and be ready to push back if that's a tactic and a way of acting that they're going to take on.
Come dead in here.
We've got to be on guard.
Seriously.
And then over to DPRK. So I would say DPRK has been some of the most consistent, right? They haven't shifted. They've always seen cyber as an effective tool of state power. But what we have is confirmation that they're going to use cyber in every strategic activity they have. When we put missile defense systems in South Korea, one of the plans of the U.S. government was to expect cyber probing, cyber efforts from DPRK to come at those systems.
Is that kind of cyber?
I think the destructive attacks they've undertaken against Sony, well understood, but they've been hitting South Korea banks, infrastructure, government for several years. We would expect that to continue. They don't have a lot to lose, and there's not a lot of levers we can use in that space to discourage it. The biggest place that they stand out amongst nation states is looking to steal hard currencies. They hit the Bank of Bangladesh for $81 million in a theft through the SWIFT network. They continue to do cryptocurrency thefts, continue to target banks, looking to get hard Western currency. And it really shows the way that as a nation state they're engaged in criminal behavior. So where do we need to be?
Where come there?
Cybersecurity really is a team sport. We in government absolutely recognize we can't do this alone. If you look at strengthening cybersecurity, it can't be something driven out of Washington, D.C. I think the greatest progress happens from the bottom up, not the top down. And that, you know, as I talked about, the election hacking village and other things that go on in forums like this and at companies in our industry, it's a place where we've got to be prepared and figure out how to let that drive from the bottom up. NSA has some unique expertise and capabilities that we track and coordinate across the overall federal efforts. There is sector-specific knowledge across the federal government, places like Treasury, who understand the financial industry, energy, who understand the power industry, that we can supply cyber expertise to, and they know domain issues. So that coordinated cross-sector government industry to protect is vital. A good example of where industry brings knowledge that we just don't and won't have, Microsoft recently highlighted intrusions against a senator's email. And what that shows is these companies, like Facebook taking down Russian troll accounts, they are going to know things on their platform and be able to see things that the government couldn't and shouldn't. And so there's got to be this connection as we work against those government nation states that are behaving badly at the federal level, and they see some of the things on their platform. There's got to be this virtuous cycle where there's engagement. I think in terms of social and our society, the Russian election meddling, the Russian divisiveness they're trying to sow is top of mind. I think many of you heard the director of NSA, General Nakasone, set up a Russia small group. He brought together people across Cyber Command and NSA to focus in on this problem.
Bruder, wo kommt der her? Ich glaube, wir müssen den Radius mal verkleinern und hier noch ein Loch einsprengen.
DHS, who can track to the state and locals, what threats they're up against that, sharing relevant threat intelligence with DHS, getting into the multi-state information sharing analysis center, the election ISACs, other places like that. So when it comes to Russia, the recent policy pronouncements really have made it clear that any attempt to go after our and interfere with our elections, successful or unsuccessful, really is a direct attack on our democracy, and it's unacceptable. So I think we're resourcing that. The National Defense Strategy laid out a role for DoD. And you're going to see us resourcing and pushing into that. So I've talked in the past about the intrusion lifecycle. I laid out, you know, as an attacker, the mindset of an attacker, how you go against a well-defended, hardened target. And, you know, you can argue about the way stops in between, but you basically have to cascade through these activities to find your way in and exploit and make use of systems. So there are points on these steps that we've got to think with a defensive mindset about breaking up, interrupting, and disrupting their ability to have success. So it's worth your time, if you're involved in any sort of defensive activity or you even want to protect yourself at home, to go after and look at this kind of model and think through where your weak points and where can you hurt. Because what you need is layered defense. One thing I can't state in strong enough words, really, the basics matter. Basics totally matter. Ignoring the basics gets you caught up in massive cyber casualty effects like WannaCry. Ignoring the basics let a nation state adversary tear into you, get to their objectives easily, and likely root into the point where you're going to be hard pressed to know if they're still in after you remediate. The basics give a beachhead for much harder follow on exploitation. Ignoring the basics will give you a beachhead for that harder follow-up. So I think regardless of the changes in technology, and there's some really cool innovative defensive things coming on, if we don't have the discipline to stick to the basics, the cool stuff really doesn't matter. Past, present, future, it's going to rely on doing the basics, because no matter how skilled an adversary is, you know, my time in the past at NSA, you only use what you absolutely need, right? Attackers are going to limit the sophistication of what they're doing. So in that, you know, there's a host of things that we need to do, where it runs from, no kidding, get that multi-factor authentication out, it matters. Enabling logging, doing the analysis,
NSA advertisement for logging, stock.
Technology. In the past, the U.S. government used to build used to build black boxes, used to have isolated government networks. We now live on that same commercial technology that banks, industry, critical infrastructures, and we as citizens live on. And there's a reason there's a patch Tuesday.
Oh, fuck.
The day that stuff comes out is the day that people start picking at it and poking at it. It's going to, over time, erode, and people are going to learn flaws. So it's important we keep up with that. It's not that this tech is either good or bad. We've got to have a way where we deal in that gray zone. And if you're a static target, if you're not improving, evolving, moving with technology, you're going to fall. So don't be, that victim that doesn't move and gets to be a victim of technical debt. So for me, asymmetric advantage is the private sector and the government working together in that, because what we found is we used to have a lot of expertise on this stuff. You think cryptography, the government had that monopoly. Today we do not. A lot of the innovation, a lot of the brain power
open source
is going to be on the West Coast. It's going to be in industry. It's going to be in private companies.
Fuck, kind of open source.
It's going to be international too, right? There's not going to be this huge dominance in Silicon Valley. We're going to see the investments going on in Asia and elsewhere. We're going to see other tribes with really important things that they can contribute. So a coordinated approach is important. So, I'll leave you with a thought here. If if you like this challenge, and it's going to be a challenge for years, and you want to be part of doing hacking for good, you want to see using some of these skills to defend the country, come to NSA.
Bruder.
Part of that. I can tell you, you can come back to DEF CON and not worry. Other three-letter agencies may be waiting here for you too, right? So we can do that hacking stuff in a legal way. You got to be clearable. Sorry, I know there's a heavy foreign contingent in here, but we'd be happy to talk to you. Go to the NSA website. So where's cyber going? It really means that we've got to innovate. We've got to be engaged every single day. We've got to counter the people who are engaging us at a level below the threshold of war, and the people are going to make the difference in that. So I've run past my time.
NSA, Werbung.
I wonder, I think we're going to go to the chill-out room. Thank you for your time and attention.
Der am besten mal hier irgendwo fett noch Produktplacement hin, so viel Werbung wie er für die NSA hier rausgehauen hat. Das ist ja der Hammer. So, wir haben jetzt hier auch schon wieder 22 Minuten. Dann würde ich sagen, mache ich hier mal einen Cut und gehe vermutlich auch kurz AFK und dann geht's weiter. Alles klar, Party People.